A hard winter wind was calling the shots the night I arrived in Roppongi to audition for the new gig. Pretty girls were flouncing down the neon streets like so many Asian apple turnovers. And it almost reminded me of that crazy night in Hong Kong in 1982 with Maya Lin, except I'd never been to Hong Kong, so it didn't. Then I spotted a big etched in granite sign for a club called the Grand Cru up on the 8th floor. So I went over and got in the elevator, and it was real quiet in there. But then when the doors opened, I stepped off the elevator, and it was all marble and deep carpets. Mahogany walls, marble pillars, chandeliers, and burnished galet vases. Tiny spotlight shone down on these pink marble tables. Marble, the faded rouge of late afternoon sunlight, caressing Greek temples overlooking the Adriatic. The color of long forgotten murals buried deep within Pompeii. It's kind of like the burnt orange of smoked salmon left in the refrigerator too long, actually. Manager walked up and shook my hand. "So, you are a pianist," he said. "No, I'm a sax player."
I don't need a sax. I need a pianist."
But at that moment, John Coltrane's music was pouring out of the speakers in the ceiling. "Gee," I said, that saxophone sounds kind of nice." Well, there was a long silence, and then he shrugged and he said, "Well, let's check out your sax." I was confused, but I lifted my trouser leg slowly, but then the guy shouted, "No, no, not your sax. Your sax, saxophone." "Oh," I said, and got out my horn, and four jazzy grooves later, people were standing around and applauding. And then they took me in the back room, and they offered me six nights a week. So now I work in a gilded room high atop fabled Roppongi, where burgundy bow tie and a tuxedo. You can't go in there if you're a woman or unescorted foreigner. The front room is filled with 30 of the loveliest young girls this side of your wildest dreams. Creme de la creme of Tokyo. Each one in a gauzy, low-cut evening dress. Their creamy shoulders and lovely necks. Their flawless skin and sculpted backs. They're mostly empty 12-year-old minds. I've been there 3 years now, filling the room with my hot, sensuous jazz. I must have made love to half a dozen of these princesses. I must have, right? Well, there were a couple of dates, but I'll leave that for later. You know, each night before the doors open, they have a staff meeting. Waiters, the cook, the doorman, they all listen carefully, and the senior waiter gives some new guys advice. Then they stand together in a lineup and begin a call and response shouted, full boot camp volume. It sounds a little bit like this. These are the words they'll scream in unison whenever customers enter or leave the premises. These guys are dedicated. They run to and from the kitchen in the course of their duties. 3 feet from a customer, they slide like baseball players to their knees to get orders. They even escort customers to the men's room. Imagine this in a Western milieu. In Vegas, for instance.
"Well, boys, we're having this meeting to see if we can pick up business a little bit and, you know, keep the customers happy, you know what I mean? Now, I was thinking, maybe we should start running around the club like maniacs and scream at people when they come in and maybe fall on our knees when we serve them. Benny, what do you think about this?"
"Boss, this won't work. A lot of our customers are kind of jumpy, you know. You scream at them, it could start trouble. And we start running around the club, people could panic. They think it was the cops or a shooter or something. And, you know, we start getting on our knees in front of the customers. Some guys could take that the wrong way."
Okay, how about we escort our customers to the bathroom?"
"Look, boss, me and the boys, we've been thinking. You've been working real hard lately. Maybe you'd like to take a nice little vacation, you know? Hey, you ever been to Japan?"
Out on the street, neon lights blink and flash around me. And everywhere, the slinky, hard-faced white girls, dancers from Australia, companions from Russia and the Czech Republic. One of them went off to Kyushu last year with a Japanese customer and got chopped into little pieces in a cave by the sea. I guess you never know who you're talking to in Roppongi. Street girls ask me if I need a massage. A tough-looking white man, his head shaved completely bald, pressures me. Hey, buddy, topless bar, topless bar. I stop and look at him. Topless bar? Look, I'm losing my hair anyway, so I'm not getting all shaved off just to go to your topless bar. Why do we all have to look like you anyway? Guy starts yelling at me about some French city. I think it was Brest. The guy's nuts. Now an old Japanese man stops me, looks in my eyes and says, Japanese girl? No, you idiot, I'm a Jewish man. Am I wearing a kimono? Is my hair dyed orange? Get out of here. He doesn't even blink. Ah, I understand. It's no problem. I can get you, Jewish man. Very clean. I give up and go back to the club. Ah, my hostesses, those angelic creatures. I'll never forget Chiharu. When they talk about women as sex objects, they're talking about Chiharu. One night I came in, I remember she seemed sad. I asked why.
My boyfriend and I just broke up. He say he too busy for me.
Does he have a history of mental disease? I asked her. A smile crossed her angelic face. Her sweet eyes could control entire states. Al Gore could have used her in Florida. Then I noticed a beautiful cross she's wearing with a silver stylized Jesus hanging there. Crosses have become a high fashion with the Japanese girls. And something was wrong with this cross. It looked more like a big T.
It's a Tiffany, she explained.
Our Lord impaled on a Tiffany logo was something I'd never imagined. I suddenly feel like Bin Laden was onto something. I'm spiritually offended. But then my archetypal Jewish merchant takes it to the next level. What's the most popular icon in Japan? Mickey Mouse. It's an obvious million-dollar idea, Mickey on the cross. His little arms spread out, his irrepressible smile. The thorn of crowns tilted just so around his big ears. Wait, I'm getting chills. It's a series. Minnie on the cross. Donald crucified. Goofy nailed. Pluto hung up to dry. Collect them all. Bubblegum cards for the kids. Cartoon stations of the cross. Mickey meets Pilate. Mickey praying in a garden. Mickey under the whip. What's not to like? This is Japan, a surreal Disneyland. Wait a minute. I gotta snap out of it. Chiharu needs my love. So, Chiharu, I got my car tonight. Come on, let's go dancing or something when you get off. Hey, I tell you what. Just come by my place for, you know, like an hour. Try singing a vocal part and an arrangement, you know, just for fun.
I don't know.
Come on, Chiharu, you be safe there. What do you think I'm gonna do, attack you? She tossed her head.
I am not worried about that.
Of course, I said if you attacked me, we'd be in trouble, you know. I mean, if after we closed the door, you walked across to me and threw your arms around my neck and snuggled up close and breathed softly against my face and pressed your mouth gently against mine. Slipped your tongue slowly between my lips. She was getting excited, I could feel it. It's time to cool her off. See, that could be dangerous, I said, because I'm thinking about your toes, mainly, because if you really did that, my knees would probably go right out and you'd be looking at 65 kilograms of Arnie headed straight down. And that's not all. Just because my knees go out, that wouldn't necessarily mean I'd let go of your tongue. I don't get kissed like that very often, believe me. I'm going to hold on to that tongue. So you're talking major tongue pull, maybe even stretch marks. Chiharu had a stunned look in her eye. So, how long is your tongue anyway? Your mouth's kind of hanging open there. Let's take a look. Well, that's a pretty healthy sized lapper you got there. I was getting too invasive. I could feel it. Definitely, I turned to a more spiritual topic. Of course, now, Chiharu, in India, you know, you have a lot of holy men who slowly elongate their tongues over decades with special stretching exercises. You know, they attach weights and stuff like that. I think the goal is to be able to penetrate your own navel with the tongue tip. It's called tongue and navel satori. I heard these guys stay in the mountains pretty much because if they show up in the city, women attack them and drag them off as sex slaves. Mysteries of the Orient, eh, Chiharu? Anyway, you weren't really planning on doing that, were you? Chiharu had a faraway look in her eyes. Gigantic waves of sexual energy were exploding off of her lip gloss. I reached out and took her hand, and she began to move her thumb back and forth in my palm. I took my keys out of my pocket and jangled them lightly in front of her like a hypnotist. But just then, the floor manager walked over. Well, actually, he waddled over. The manager is this ivory-feathered white pelican named Sydney. He always wears a Pierre Cardin tuxedo with lavender bow tie around his downy neck. Sydney just looked up at me with this profound, nearly human expression that seemed to penetrate into my deepest being. Then he nudged Chiharu with one wing and pushed her toward her next customer. Ah, Roppongi, what a town. But let me tell you, that pelican was looking good.